Lesson 9 Out of unity you arise. The return to unity is your destiny. The mind discovers the path of return while the heart provides the key to each stage along the way, dear friend. The secret sciences currently called occult sciences are in fact the application of nature's evolutionary methods. The true goal of this knowledge is the making of each one into an authentically free being and a knower, in the appropriate amount of time. The sciences have been hidden, occulto in Latin, for a long time by fear that exoteric forces could take hold of them and destroy them as a result of not knowing how to use them. Moreover, history, particularly during the Inquisition, abounds with examples of such deeds, as consequences of careless revelations. If we really want to advance on the evolutionary path, sooner or later we need to approach and utilize one or several of these disciplines. Therefore, we think it useful to present their genuine content in broad outlines. In Western countries, occult sciences have been practiced by adepts who, for the most part, have been called Rosicrucians. For all practical purposes, the true Rose Cross has in fact dissolved the veil of the second death and could not make any public appearance. The study of the clear and coded texts inherited from the ancients shows that they all worked principally on a triptych of knowledge, alchemy, magic, astrology. This triptych of sciences are often accompanied by coding and decoding tools such as symbolism, numerology, and mythology. The associations of journeymen in the Middle Ages, which were probably working in relation with these adepts, carved the symbolism of this knowledge into stone. The three portals of the cathedrals are in fact attempts to summarize these three major sciences. Generally, there is an alchemical, a magical, and an astrological portal. We shall examine these sciences one at a time. Alchemy. In the ancient texts, this subject is often found under the title of medicine. Alchemy is actually a set of preparatory medicines leading to initiation. In summary, alchemy can be divided into four kinds of medicines: medicine of the body, medicine of the soul, medicine of knowledge, and medicine of nature. 1. Spagyrics, or medicine of the body. We should remind you now that all the beings of the three kingdoms, mineral, plant, and animal, have a soul, that is, they possess an animating energy, self or pound. They also have a salt copyright which molds the nature of their body, and they have a mercury which ensures the connection between the two. This law applies to all beings of all kingdoms. The alchemists say that everything is subject to the life energies which involve and evolve under the pressure of astrological energies. Spagyrics essentially concerns the plant kingdom and consists in, as its Greek name announces, separating and reuniting. In fact, there is a bit more to do. Briefly, let's say that there is separation of the principles, purification of the separated principles, reunion of the purified principles. Thus, we obtain powerfully healing remedies without toxic effects. In other words, bodies whose densities are in accord with the different levels of energy. Spagyric remedies sometimes issue from the mineral kingdom, but generally to the exclusion of the seven traditional metals of the metallic realm. These metals are used in another phase of the alchemical work. Moreover, the first goal of spagyrics is not the healing of the body. In effect, it is to prepare the body in such a way that it can go through initiation. For this purpose, each level of consciousness is to be treated by one or several plants which are appropriate for that level. 2. Initiation, or medicine of the soul. This second aspect of alchemy is certainly its major feature. By using the properties of the ores of metals, the adept can influence the energies of his intermediary bodies and thus progressively clear the barriers which separate him from his various levels of consciousness. In order to understand this chapter well, let's once again go back to the figure of Lesson 3, which refers to the following explanations. Each level of energy corresponds to a density of man, a subtle body. However, there is a difference between the different subtle bodies and the very dense body of the earth. Three subtle bodies gather to form a world. Thus, levels 9, 8, 7 form a world which comprises a threefold density and a trinitary consciousness. In this world, The walls between 9 to 8 and 8 to 7 are weakened, but the levels are still to be re-established, one by one. It is the same for levels 6, 5, 4, which also form a world in which the element of balance is level 6. Here the walls between 5 to 6 and 4 to 6 are weakened. If we consider the almost complete separation of the levels of consciousness, there is a separation between the body of level 10 and the bodies of levels 9, 8, 7 through the veil of birth and death. There is also separation between the bodies of levels 9, 8, 7 and those of levels 6, 5, 4 through the veil of the second death. Finally, there is a separation between the bodies of levels 6, 5, 4 and those of levels 3, 2, 1 through the veil of eternity, called the veil of the abyss. In fact, levels 3, 2, 1 cannot be considered as bodies. Therefore, we have 6 subtle or intermediary bodies. It is also said that we have 7 bodies, including the physical body. It is also said that there are 3 bodies in man if we consider our world and the 2 worlds above it, which have 3 levels each, as we just mentioned. Of course, the work on the metallic realm is interesting, from a point of view of initiation, only once you have established, through spagyrics, a field which allows you to use the products issuing from the metallic realm without risks. Here, each level of consciousness should be treated by a specific metal. 3. Medicine of knowledge. The knowledge of secular science is an acquired knowledge which is voluntarily limited because it systematically ignores, or denies, the spiritual aspect of things and beings. This is not the case with alchemy, because in order for its methods to be successful, you must constantly take into account the spiritual and life principles. Besides, the alchemical operations progressively lead the adept to a communion with nature and matter, which provides a direct revelation of knowledge. The adept learns then, through this contact, the reality of the nature of the being, of his origin and growth. 4. Medicine of nature. Involution occurs throughout nature, including man. The consequences which one and the other undergo are identical. Perhaps the consequences are heavier on nature due to man's ignorance of his actions. But once he has been initiated by alchemy, the adept possesses the means to help nature to repair the consequences of involution and repair man's errors. In this particular domain, his powers are almost without limits. The alchemical initiation obligatorily includes the mastery of the 4 medicines. Magic in the West. True magic has a cabalistic origin, regardless of the detours taken from this origin. As a matter of fact, magic has always been more or less infused with Kabbalah, because it uses the power of resonance of the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. The power of resonance at play is produced either by the graphic symbolism of the letters or by pronouncing them aloud. Hebrew is closer to the original word than our modern languages. The true aim of magic, or Kabbalah, is the manipulation of spiritual energies with a view to initiation. If alchemy manipulates the energies through their relationship to their physical matrix, magic, or Kabbalah, manipulates them by means of symbols. In this domain, there is a first phase which consists in acquiring a view of the entire universe and man, because we should know the map well before we set out on the journey. Then, we have a preparation phase which consists in purifying and rebalancing each of the energetic levels of consciousness, by reharmonizing the elements, each one in relation to the others. The goal of this operation is to eliminate the scoria accumulated during involution in the various levels of consciousness. Religions would say to eliminate the consequences of the so-called original sin. Once this operation is complete, we can undertake the third phase, which consists in working on the walls separating the different levels of consciousness. In Kabbalah, we call the possible passages through these walls paths, and Kabbalah says that they are 22 in number. As an aside, some representations of Jacob's ladder, about which we spoke in Lesson 6, have 22 steps. Several keys can open these passages: Daro, the Hebrew letters, vocalization and meditation, the astrological symbols, signs or planets, which are all a welcome, accessory help. Magic never operates against the laws of nature. Like alchemy, it respects the laws which rule creation. Its results seem supernatural to the layman because he ignores the nature of the rules which are used and the causal laws behind effects. This is not the case with the magus or the cabalist who, knowing how to access certain laws of the higher levels, can transcend and command the constituents of the lower planes. In order to attain this, he has various methods at his disposal, the choice of which essentially depends on the applications he foresees. In the beginning, the apprentice can create chords and resonance with the higher levels only through the use of symbols, grouped in the form of a ritual. There are rituals for each level and rituals for each element. The ritual, as we saw, has only a temporary role. Indeed, it creates, little by little, an automatic inner link, and as soon as this is accomplished, it becomes of no more use. Aside from the rituals, there is another means of access to the higher levels, which consists in causing the intermediary bodies to travel. This outing is called astral travel, or astral projection, and it liberates the consciousness from the prison of the body. Thus, it permits a direct contact with planes higher than the earthly plane. This method incurs many risks, and our belief is that it is unwise to use it if you do not already possess a great deal of esoteric experience and if you haven't gone through a thorough cleansing of your inner worlds. In a sense, we can say that natural magic is concerned with our growth, our evolution, our inner being. The other aspect of magic has to do with the use outside of us. It is the magic called, often wrongly, ceremonial magic, and which, always wrongly, is sometimes called black, sometimes white. Do you have the right to use these methods to help others? As long as you need these rituals for yourself, as long as your inner master doesn't present itself to you in the course of the night school, we do not advise you to do so. As a matter of fact, the risks of error are considerable, and it is better not to touch the material or spiritual growth of others because, in this case, the consequences of errors are deadly. Anyway, an important rule is that what you ask for should not be contrary to the growth necessity of another. Magic, like Kabbalah, teaches man to take responsibility for himself. As a study, but even more as a practice, it is doubtlessly the first attempt of unitary response of the universe. It brings an answer to man's three most important questions: who are we? Where do we come from? Where do we go? Astrology for the esoteric student. Astrology is interesting for two reasons. First, he can strengthen his psychic faculties, and second, he can work at a propitious time for him. Studying his own astrological elements gives him the possibility of determining the elements he particularly needs to work on. The study of the astrological symbols creates resonances in him which give him access to a better knowledge of himself. Here more than ever, everything we mentioned about this subject in the class is important. As a matter of fact, working on each of the inner worlds from level 9 to 3 included, occurs in correspondence with the planet concerned. We won't bring up this subject again. After he masters his energies sufficiently, the student is then capable of using the astrology of the planetary geniuses. This allows him to find the propitious time not only during the week but also during the day or even during the hour. Lesson 6. Esoteric astrology. The Earth traces out an ellipse as it travels around the Sun. Every ellipse has two focal points. The visible Sun occupies one of these centers while the other is occupied by the invisible Sun, often called the Black Sun, which radiates the life energies, the non-material energies, needed for the Earth. All the planets of the solar system describe ellipses around the Sun, as each of these ellipses is different. There is an invisible Sun for each planet, the invisible Sun of Saturn, Mars, etc. Astronomically speaking, these invisible suns are never far away from our Sun, except for the invisible Sun of Saturn, which is located between the orbits of Venus and Mercury. They are closer to one another than planets are to each other. The invisible Sun of Venus is very close to the Sun. The true astrological influences, which are of a spiritual order, come from the interaction between the invisible suns. As an example, The invisible sun of Saturn acts on its planet, which reacts back to it, and its invisible sun in turn acts on the sun of the Earth. All the elements of the solar system act reciprocally one upon the other. Besides, the invisible suns do not move in relation to our sun, they are therefore a symbol of the fixed laws of the universe. The adept interested in this aspect of astrology should make all the related calculations. If he is thwarted in this study, he should resort to the energies of the planetary geniuses. As a summary, alchemy would be the study of chemistry plus life, magic the study of physics plus life, and astrology the study of astronomy plus life. Symbolism. Symbolism is not properly speaking a secret science. It is, as we saw, lessons 4 and 5, a practical tool of Kabbalah magic or a decoding tool mostly for esoteric texts. If your mind is well impregnated with symbolism, the journey on the path will be considerably easier. Numerology. Numerology, as we saw it through the 10 levels and particularly through the study of numbers, lesson 6, sheds light on the esoteric meaning of numbers and names, through gematria. It is also used to code certain texts, Vigenère, Trithemius. Mythology. Mythological narratives are analogies of magical or alchemical operations. The first part of the initiatory path is difficult because our intuition is still weak and the inner contact non-existent. Therefore, we have a need for outer, intellectual knowledge for the preparation of our journey. This knowledge cannot be expressed in a clear language accessible to all, and so the servants of the invisible devised mythical narratives, fairy tales and legends. The point is to recognize the true ones, in order to explain the required stages of the journey. Expressing this knowledge by means of symbols presents two advantages. On the one hand, it is sheltered from the risk of destruction by profane forces. On the other, we know that symbolic language is the best means to get through to the inner self. As an example, Ovid's Metamorphosis describes the way of the alchemical path. The Greek and Roman gods symbolize the attributes of the different levels, and the labors of Hercules symbolize the stages of the path. For those interested in the subject, one of the best texts decoding mythology is probably the Greek and Egyptian fables, with commentary by Pierre. Many schools claim that they provide esoteric education. Depending on their objectives and knowledge, they propose tools to awaken the student which are more or less appropriate. Remember, regardless which is the most advanced school, there always comes a phase in which the student must take responsibility for himself. Nothing can exempt him from his work. Any school which lives up to its name should lead the student to the gate of the temple. Then, he and he alone can knock, and if the door opens, he is offered the knowledge of that which lies beyond the veil. Oratory work proposed exercise, the descent the energies, to be effected once you have accomplished the awakening of the levels in 30 consecutive days 3×10, lesson #4 oratory. Usual setup. Place the figure of the 40 invocations, lesson 5, in front of you. Vocalize the four names of each level in the order fire, air, water, earth, starting with level 1 and descending toward level 10. Follow the rhythm of one level per minute. Remain passive for a few minutes. Usual closing. When you want to operate on one level only during an exercise in the oratory, it is imperative that you always perform a descent of the energy starting from level 1. Thus, there is no risk of disturbing nature's energies nor of experiencing the uncomfortable resulting consequences. In lesson 12, we shall explain how to operate on a single level. This rapid descent can be performed each time you need to charge yourself. Note A. The vocalization of the four names in this system of ritual is only compatible with the exercises given here or with the Hebrew Kabbalah. We do not know of possible interactions with rituals of other origins. B. The vocalizations function because they are an image of the word, and the word is senior to energy. Aura et labora. Appendix, the chemical sky, figure #1 with list of features, the chemical sky. Appendix, the chemical sky. A careful study of the works of adepts from the past points out that Basil, Valentine, Trithemius, Agrippa, Paracelsus were simultaneously alchemists, cabalists and astrologers. You may prefer one over the other two designated ways, but you cannot completely neglect the other two. As an example, let's take the reading of the Chemical Sky by Jacques Dole. It is both an alchemical and cabalistic synthesis, also in accordance with traditional astrology. However, this synthesis, which tends to be unitary, makes it difficult to separate the studies of alchemy, Kabbalah and astrology from one another. The symbolism is astrological but can be interpreted following the very nature of the practical works you are undertaking. The first obvious remark is that each planet is assigned to two signs of the zodiac, a positive and a negative one, except for the Sun and the Moon, which are assigned to only one sign. If we consider that the medium Kali is the point of junction between Aquarius and Capricorn, then it is the point at which the unitary energy, energy of unity, is introduced into the solar system. The role of Saturn, already studied, is to manifest duality. The unitary energy can be divided into two branches, one leading to the side Aquarius, Pisces, etc., which is the lunar branch. The other leading toward Capricorn, Sagittarius, etc., which is the solar branch. At each level, the energies remain polarized. For example, at level 4 and 4, we have Pisces, negative, and Sagittarius, positive. With each change in level, the energy changes sign. There is a symmetry in relation to the vertical axis passing through the junctions Aquarius, Capricorn, and Cancer Leo. However, the two parts are always complementary. Each branch includes a six-step cycle, that is, two times a cycle of three, lesson six, the lunar branch starting with a positive phase of three steps, ending with a three-step negative phase. The solar branch starting with a three-step negative phase, ending with a three-step positive phase. The energy thus prepared leaves the solar branch through the sign Leo with a positive aspect to teed the solar astral, and leaves the lunar branch through the sign of Cancer with a negative aspect to feed the lunar astral. Thus,